الحمد لله رب العالمين، وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين وسلم تسليما كثيرا. All praises due to Allah. We praise Him abundantly and we ask Allah to send His peace and His blessings and to exalt the mention of the Prophet Muhammad, His companions and all those who follow them on their righteous path until the Day of Judgment. A person gets in his car, fancy car, Bentley, Mercedes, BMW, whatever you consider to be fancy. The car is very nice. The interior is leather, you know, the dashboard is wood, and it's just a very special car, very attractive. And this person has the intention to go on a trip, assuming you reside in Jeddah, and you would like to go to Mecca. Now, upon entering the car, depending on the individual, you may get so mesmerized with that which you are looking at, that you don't pay attention to the gas gauge, which is on empty. Now, there are three kinds of people. One kind of individual who will see the empty sign, right, the gas gauge on empty, and he says to himself, I must go to a gas station, refill my tank prior to going on my journey. Otherwise, I will not make it. Another kind of individual is one who gets so busy looking at the other fancy things in the car that he does not even pay attention to the gas gauge. No preparation. He's just too overwhelmed, particularly if his wife and his children, they're with him in the car. You know, come on there, let's go. You know, something along these lines, huh? Getting him busy, busy. Come on, we gotta buy some toys, we gotta have some lunch and what have you. He will not even pay attention to the gas gauge. And chances are he's gonna run out of gas on the way. And the last kind of individual is someone who sees the gas gauge on empty, but then he likes to play tricks. He says, I'll make it. And he knows he won't make it. I mean, you cannot make it from Jeddah to Mecca on empty. You may, you know, if you had a little higher, you may manage. But obviously, logically, you cannot make it. But he will continue to trick himself. I'll make it, I'll make it. I'll just manage. Maybe, somehow, maybe this car is so nice inside that maybe also the engine will work with me. And it will somehow get me there without any gas. Now, of course, this is what we call a metaphor. It's a metaphoric statement, running on empty. Someone who's running on empty, meaning someone who's moving on E. And this is actually a similitude to a number of things. The car, actually, Jeddah, is the current life that we are living. It's a symbol. It symbolizes life that we are living. And Mecca, I guess Mecca in this case, is our destination, which is here, the hereafter, the life to come. The fancy car, or you may not have a fancy car, is the actual worldly life, the material world, more specifically the material world from everything, especially with the children and the wife, which are part of that material world. And then the gas, huh? Is what?
Time.
Huh?
Iman.
Iman. Who said Iman? MashaAllah. It's Iman. You can't get there without Iman. The first kind of individual is what I want this lecture to be about. The objective of this lecture is that we are the first individual who looks at the gas gauge and say, hey, I don't think my Iman is doing too well. I need to go put some gas. Or I need to refill my Iman. I need to renew my Iman. The other kind of individual is someone who is so busy with this worldly life that he does not even notice that he doesn't have enough Iman. Too busy. And the last kind of individual is someone who's been tricked by the shaitan that he will somehow manage because Allah is Ghafoor al-Rahim. Well, I will just get there. I will just get there because Allah is merciful. So then, you know, khalas, I will worry about it then. And in reality, we cannot afford to be the second or the third. We ought to be the first. First kind of individual. And the objective tonight is to see where does our iman stand. Are we among those who are running on empty? If so, then alhamdulillah that we are given an opportunity to rectify our condition. So we can recognize this danger sign and go to the gas station and fill it up. But in the case of iman, you're not going to go to a gas station. You don't need 95 or 91. Huh? You need other kind of material which will be the source for our iman. And bi-idhnillah, by the time we are done with this particular lecture, we will have the main hints or the main things that will aid us in increasing our iman and ensuring that we are traveling on full and not on empty. And Allah's success, Allah's is the source of success. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to assist me and assist you in understanding this particular subject matter and the right context. What is iman? Iman, lexically, and also from a sharia standpoint, is not synonymous with tasdeeq, which is a very common misconception. Tasdeeq means belief or faith. Iman is not synonymous with belief or faith. Although whenever you hear it in the da'wah course, whenever you are hearing da'wah, you hear all you who believe when speaking of iman. Now it doesn't mean that those who are using it are making a mistake, no. It's just that we must understand that the Arabic language is a lot richer than the English language. And so we use the word belief or iman because we have no other option. Otherwise we have to give a long definition every time we want to use the word iman. But because of the inevitability of time, we say iman means faith or belief. But it is more than that. Because tasdeeq is just to believe, not really believe something. But you may believe something and do nothing about it. Like Satan. Does Satan believe in God? Does he believe in Allah? You better believe. He has tasdeeq. Didn't he? He was worshipping Allah among the angels. Allah spoke to him. But he was missing the second part, which is inqiyat. Inqiyat, which is more like iqrar. So the right definition for iman is belief with iqrar, which is accepting with the actions of the heart. The actions of the heart is relevant to that. Not only the heart believing, there must be action, which is really submissiveness or compliance. Inqiyat. So in summary, iman is that which you accept as true, but then furthermore there are other actions of the heart, the limbs, and the tongue, which either confirm or negate that iman. So according to Ahlus, why am I giving you this definition? You will be shocked that there are many denominations among the Muslims who believe otherwise. Who believe iman is simply to believe. So if you believe in Allah and the angels, huh, and the books and the messengers, and the day of judgment and preordainment, then your iman is equal to that of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu wa arda. There's absolutely no difference between you and him. Even if you drink alcohol, even if you do drugs, even if you fornicate, it doesn't matter. You believe in the six pillars of iman? Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu believed in the six pillars of iman. You and him are on the same page in the iman. And we say this is unacceptable. Because we know that iman increases and decreases. It increases with good deeds and it decreases with evil deeds. If we commit sin, our iman will go low. This is to what part? Not the part of believing in the six pillars of iman, rather the compliance of the heart. To what extent do you have sami'na wa ata'na? To what extent do we have, we listen and we obey? The more we have that, the more we have iman. Otherwise, you may have the basic belief in the six pillars of faith, but it does not generate any good deeds. It does not generate any submission to Allah. So we say that this person, his iman is running low, and perhaps he may lose even the six pillars of faith unless this person does something to rectify his or her condition. the causes for the decrease of iman. They are actually internal causes and external causes. And we'll be dividing them in this fashion, then dealing with each on its own bi-idhnillah. The first is ignorance. And there's a very common statement in the world. Maybe you've heard it before, maybe you have not. It goes like this: ignorance is bliss. Anyone heard that before? Okay. Actually, this is one of the most false statements ever said by a human being after kufr and shirk and everything else. Bliss is happiness. Bliss is when you're happy. And these people are trying to tell me and you that ignorance is bliss. Yani, what you don't know, you will be happy. And we say, this is crazy. How in the world is not knowing something going to make you happy? Let's say that your toilet flush goes out. طيب, if you had knowledge of fixing it, you'll be happy. You don't have to hire a plumber. You don't have to use other means to clean until the plumber comes. You don't have to go through a lot of hassle because you have a little knowledge, which is to lift up this, you know, little tab and do the fixing yourself. So we say knowledge is never harmful in any aspect of life. But beneficial knowledge of the deen is the one that will elevate one's status in this life and in the hereafter. But ignorance is not bliss. Actually, ignorance is the main reason why we will have lack of faith. And this has been indicated in the Qur'an. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He combined ignorance with shirk. Allah says, قُلْ أَفَغَيْرَ اللَّهِ تَأْمُرُونِي أَعْبُدُ أَيُّهَا الْجَاهِلُونَ. Say, do you order me to worship other than Allah, O ignorant people? Meaning anyone who tells you to worship other than Allah is ignorant. And when you are worshipping other than Allah, you have no iman. So your iman is definitely low. Whereas, when you are establishing tawheed, and you have knowledge of tawheed, then your iman will increase. So that being ignorant about the affairs of our deen is a calamity. Just imagine if you entered into the salah, and you missed one of the takbirat. Or you missed to say subhana rabbi al-azim in the ruku', or any aspect of the salah. If we don't have knowledge of how to fix that by doing sujood al-sahu and whether it is a rukun or a wajib, you know the division among the with the fuqaha, then we will be in trouble. We will not do the salah properly. Our salah may not be accepted because we did not have knowledge. So then ignorance, of course, is opposed by knowledge. And it is one of the things that may lead to destruction, to the destruction of one of us. Now, anytime we disobey Allah, then we are doing it out of ignorance, whether intentionally or not. And this is according to Qatada, radiallahu anhu, he said, the companions assembled, and they concluded that every act of disobedience is out of ignorance, whether intentionally or not. Why is that? First, because for you to be sinful, you must have knowledge that what you're doing is prohibited. For you to be considered sinful, you must know that this is haram, then you do it. If you didn't know that it's haram, are you held accountable with Allah? No. Huh? The principle in the deen is that we are excused for that which we do not know about. Right or wrong? Right. If you don't know about something, you are not held accountable for ignorance. Of course, it depends on what it is. You cannot be ignorant of Allah and Tawheed. We're talking about things that we can afford ignorance. Being ignorant about. If you do not have knowledge of that thing, and you do it, then you're not sinful. The only time you're sinful is when you know it's haram, and you do it anyways. So that means every time we're disobeying Allah, we're doing that out of ignorance. Why? Because only an ignorant person knows that if you do such an act, it will result in your potential destruction, your iman will increase, your sustenance may be also decreased, you may get hated by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you may be led astray, and we still do the bad deed. You see, that's jahil. That's a form of ignorance. Because knowledge indicates that when you know something is harmful, you don't approach it. If there's a cake, and in the cake, there's poison. If you had knowledge, would you eat from this cake? No. Only if you are ignorant. Although you know there's poison in the cake, you still ate from it out of ignorance because you were not really thinking about the consequences of your action. You may become poisoned, you may pass away, and things of the sort. So then ignorance, every act of worship, every sinful act that we commit is actually done out of ignorance. And that does not mean that it is okay for us to continue to do that. So brothers and sisters in Islam, ignorance is among the main reasons why our iman will decrease. Because we will not know how to worship Allah. And so we are expected to increase our knowledge, so our iman will increase at the same time. Heedlessness. A potato eating popcorn. And what is heedlessness? It is when someone is not mindful of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala first, of the angels who are writing down his deeds second, and of the day of judgment, accountability on the day of judgment, heaven, hell, and everything else, every aspect of Islam. When someone is heedless, meaning that person is not paying attention to that, we are absent-minded. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, وَلَقَدْ ذَرَأْنَا لِجَهَنَّمْ كَثِيرًا مِنَ الْجِنِّ وَالْإِنْسِ لَهُمْ قُلُوبٌ لَا يَفْقَهُونَ بِهَا وَلَهُمْ أَعْيُنٌ لَا يُبْصِرُونَ بِهَا وَلَهُمْ آذَانٌ لَا يَسْمَعُونَ بِهَا أُولَٰئِكَ كَالْأَنْعَامِ بَلْ هُمْ أَضَلْ أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْغَافِلُونَ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, and we have created for Jahannam a lot of jinn and mankind who have hearts by which they do not understand. And they have eyes by which they do not see. And they have ears by which they do not hear. They are like the cattle, equal animals. Nay, they are more astray. Verily, those are the heedless. So when we have a heart that doesn't understand the obligations and the prohibitions, and we have eyes that don't see the truth, and we have ears that do not hear the truth in a manner where we implement it after we hear it, then we are among the heedless, and the heedless is synonymous with the animals, and the animals are actually better, because Allah created them to worship, and they glorify Allah every day and every night. وَإِن مِّن شَيْءٍ إِلَّا يُسَبِّحُ بِحَمْدِهِ وَلَكِنْ لَا تَفْقَهُونَ تَسْبِيحَهُمْ Allah says, there's nothing except that it glorifies Allah, but you don't understand the glorification. So then the animal was created to be used by us, and it doesn't go against that. And the animal was created to worship Allah, and it submits to Allah. Then this son of Adam is doing the opposite. That makes the animal better than the human being in this sense. Because we share the other things of marriage and children and eating and drinking. I mean, we are alike. What is the distinction between us and the other creatures? Is the fact that we have hearts that understand and eyes that see the truth. And that means we should act according to it. And ears that hear the truth. And also that means we should act in accordance with it. So then, heedlessness, being absent-minded of Allah, is among the main reasons why our iman will decrease. And brothers and sisters in Islam, I want you to imagine yourself, at work. You are sitting behind your desktop, your PC. And we may be doing something haram. We may be doing something that is not acceptable. When we are heedless of Allah, we will not care. You see, we will continue to do it. Because at no point, if we thought for a moment, Allah is watching me. Huh? Allah is watching me. I'm gaining sin. I will be asked about this on the day of judgment. We may stop. You start speaking to yourself. You start speaking to yourself. What am I doing? Astaghfirullah. Huh? You change whatever you're doing. Why? Because you bring to mind the fact that Allah Azza wa Jal is observing you. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is watching over you. So when do we commit sins negligently, without caring, is when we are heedless of Allah. And Allah warned us from that in the Quran. وَلَا تَكُونُوا كَالَّذِينَ نَسُوا اللَّهِ فَأَنْسَاهُمْ أَنفُسَهُمْ أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْفَاسِقُونَ And do not be like those who forgot about Allah. So in return, He made them forget about themselves. Meaning they did not know how to save themselves from the punishment. Verily, those are the transgressors. Those are the corrupt individuals. Those who forgot about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when we are mindful of Allah, we will have haya, modesty, where we will be ashamed of disobeying Allah openly, without caring, without feeling remorse, without feeling regret, without trying to repent to Allah, without seeking His forgiveness, without changing our ways. So all these are relevant to the heedlessness that many of the Muslims today may be experiencing. And if our iman is running on E, then this is among the main reasons. So what do we do in order to resolve this problem? We always remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the remembrance of Allah is not only by the tongue. It is with the mind, with the heart. Remember the greatness of Allah. That if Allah willed, He will take revenge from one of us. And no one will be able to aid us. Not the loved ones, not our family members, not our boss. No one can come and aid one of us if Allah will to take revenge. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala haleem. Allah pardons and He forgives. But that doesn't mean that we take advantage of that. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is also shadeedul iqab. Allah is severe in punishment. So the heedlessness by the statement of Allah is the quality of the fasiqoon. Those who go away from the obedience of Allah. The disobedient. And brothers and sisters in Islam, none of us can afford that in our lives either. Thirdly, disobedience and sins. Committing sins, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned in the hadith of Abu Huraira, which was narrated by both Bukhari and Muslim with different wording of the hadith. Actually, the hadith was narrated by more than one scholar of hadith. I will combine all of them to give you the juice, as they say, of the meaning of the hadith. I'm not quoting the hadith per word, but the meaning. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that whenever a servant commits a sin, a black dot is stamped on his heart. A black dot is stamped on his heart. If this person seeks forgiveness from Allah and he repents, then that sin, that black dot, is erased. It's erased. But if he does not, or she does not, then this dot will remain. And then every time you gain more sin, then you will continue to get more dots until the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ said, these sins will cover the heart. And this is a manifestation of the statement of Allah in Surah Al-Mutaffifin, كَلَّا بَلْ رَانَ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبِهِمْ مَا كَانُوا يَكْسِبُونَ. Nay, rather it has covered their hearts that which they used to earn from sins. And this is the biggest calamity in the world. When we commit so many sins that our hearts become covered, and when our hearts are covered, we no longer understand. So a brother will remind you and you will not be reminded. You will read the Quran and you will not implement. You hear the advice of the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ and you will throw it behind your back. Why? Because there are veils and layers over the heart. And just imagine this with any bowl. You get a bowl that is supposed to be open. And you put aluminum foil all around it. And a number of layers. Can you put anything in the bowl? Every time you put it, it's going to stay on top. And it will just fly off. You try to throw something, a basketball into a basket. You put some wood up there, it's never going to go in. And similarly, if our hearts are covered with sins, then we will no longer take the reminder. And this is the biggest calamity. This is among the biggest calamities, because usually a person does not even know that he is among these people. The person will not even pay attention to the fact that his heart is diseased. Not even diseased, it's dead. Dead, ya akhwan. And this is among the worst things that can happen to one of us. Because we will not be saved on the Day of Judgment except with this heart. يَوْمَ لَا يَنْفَعُ مَالٌ وَلَا بَنُونَ إِلَّا مَنْ أَتَى اللَّهَ بِقَلْبٍ سَلِيمٍ. On the day where no wealth or children will be of any benefit to any one of us except the one who comes to Allah with a sound heart. So how is a heart going to be sound when it has been covered with so many layers? And this is why we should never disregard a sin. Some people say, yeah, it's just a small sin. It's just a small sin. If you understand this hadith, then you will no longer say it's just a small sin. The Salaf, the righteous predecessors, used to say, do not look at the size of the sin, look at the majesty of the one you're disobeying. Look at the majesty of Allah whom you're disobeying. You cannot consider a sin small or big because it may be accompanied with many other sins and diseases of the heart that we don't pay attention. So then, brothers and sisters in Islam, we should not disregard any kind of sin. The smallest one is going to affect us sooner or later unless we repent to Allah. Unless we turn in repentance to Allah, and this is from the mercy of Allah. That if we did do many bad things, and I don't think any one of us here is different than that kind of individual. All of us have our own basket of disobedience and sin and transgression. But we hope in the mercy of Allah, and we know that Allah promised that if we turn in repentance, we will be repented. But the problem is, our hearts may be covered to such an extent where we will never be given success for tawbah. We will never really do a tawbah, and we will die before ever repenting to Allah. And if we die before repentance, and our hearts were in the state of being covered because of sins and disobedience, then brothers and sisters in Islam, Jannah may not be within reach. Jannah may not be within reach. And none of us would even want to imagine what it is like not to go to Jannah. Because it's not just missing Jannah. If it was just about missing Jannah and staying outside, it's fine. But it's you go somewhere else. If you're not going to Jannah, then you go to Jahannam. And there's no third destination. No third destination. Ashabul A'raf, they will only be there for some point in time. Then at the end of the day, they'll go to Jannah. So when it's all said and done, you have one of two destinations. So if we don't go to Jannah, we go to Jahannam. So a little sin may take us to Jahannam. Not because of the sin itself, because it being accompanied and associated with many other sins, that it will reach a point where our hearts will become covered. So then the objective of this particular topic is that when we do commit a small sin, we should also repent to Allah from that small sin. So we'll not remain stamped in our heart to such an extent where our hearts will have rain, which is this ran that Allah mentioned in Surah Al-Mutaffifin, layers, veils. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us our sins. External causes. Our enemy, Shaitan. Now you may be thinking, what is this image about? Actually, this is a manifestation, more or less, in meaning, metaphorically or figure of speech, of the hadith of Prophet Muhammad that no man and woman are in seclusion except that Shaitan is their third. And he will be given a big chair because he will be given dominance. He'll be given authority in these particular situations because that event was based on disobedience. And Allah said to Shaitan, "Inna ibadi laysa laka alayhim sultan illa man ittaba'aka min al-ghawin." Allah said to Shaitan when he made this claim that he will take many among the human being and jinn to Jahannam, Allah told him, "Verily my servants, you shall have no authority over them, except those who follow you among the evildoers." So then when two people are in a state of evil, then the shaitan has more power than he is supposed to have. Had we been under the limitations of Allah, then he would not have such authority. Anyways, Allah told us in the Quran, إِنَّ الشَّيْطَانَ لَكُمْ عَدُوٌ فَاتَّخِذُوهُ عَدُوًا. Verily the shaitan is an enemy to you, so take him as an enemy. Consider him to be an enemy. And how do you treat your enemy? Do you bring him flowers? Huh? Have you ever seen, you know, the countries during World War I and World War II when billions of people died and Islam had nothing to do with it, but they don't call this terrorism. This is called freedom fighting, loving peace, and blah, blah, blah. You know, all the nonsense that they try to propagate now and wash the people's brain with it. Now, alhamdulillah, we don't believe that hype. Because all these people died for land, for country, for politics, and had nothing to do with Islam. Alhamdulillah. Anyways, how did they treat one another? Each country was preparing itself armed to the teeth, as they say. Submarines and planes and rockets and missiles and what have you. Why? It's your enemy. And you have to be careful when you're dealing with your enemy because his goal is to put you down. He wants to nail you down. He wants to terminate you. So you must have some preparation, huh, to protect yourself and to terminate him. Now in the case of the shaitan, because he's our enemy, then we should be mindful. Abu Darda, radiallahu anhu, said, It is from the intelligence of the individual that he observes his iman, whether it is increasing or decreasing. And it is also from the intelligence of the individual that he knows from where does the shaitan enter upon him. What is your weakness? Each one of us has a weakness, depending on his nature. And this is the door that the shaitan will often use to enter, the door of the weakness. So we must be aware of it and strengthen it. So the shaitan is our enemy, and we must treat him as such, because he will whisper to one of us to commit the sin. And when he sees one of us doing good, he will try to come to you from other doors of goodness in order to lead you astray. Meaning he will not cease to fight against us until our life is over, until you expire, until your soul leaves your body. Not even at the last moments of death, the shaitan may come to one of us and try to lead him astray and tell him to accept another religion other than Islam. So this is an ongoing battle. It begins now, it's begun before, and we are living it as we speak. As I'm speaking, shaitan is whispering to me, such as, do this for the sake of people, not for the sake of Allah. Huh? Show off. And he may be whispering some other things to each one of us right now. If we know these entrances, and we seek Allah's protection, then we can protect ourselves from the shaitan, because he is among the external causes that will make our iman decrease. And so we should be mindful of these facts. Actually, there's a very interesting, a number of verses in Surah Az-Zukhruf. And we quoted these before, but it is a good reminder to quote them again for those who are coming here for the first time. Allah says regarding this reality between the son of Adam and the shaitan, وَمَنْ يَعْشُ عَنْ ذِكْرِ الرَّحْمَنِ نُقَيِّدْ لَهُ شَيْطَانًا فَهُوَ لَهُ قَرِيمٌ وَإِنَّهُمْ لَيَصُدُّونَهُمْ عَنِ السَّبِيلِ وَيَحْسَبُونَ أَنَّهُمْ مُهْتَدُونَ حَتَّى إِذَا جَاءَنَا قَالَ يَا لَيْتَ بَيْنِي وَبَيْنَكَ بُعْدَ الْمَشْرِقَيْنِ فَبِئْسَ الْقَرِينُ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, whoever turns away from the remembrance of Allah. And the remembrance of Allah, brothers and sisters, is everything that is in Islam. Being mindful of Allah is a form of remembrance. The Quran is a remembrance. The Sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is a remembrance. Everything in Islam is the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he has preserved and protected. Whoever turns away from my remembrance, look at this, then we will assign for him a shaitan. And he will become his kareem. Kareem is an intimate companion. You know, among your friends, you have someone who's very close to you, huh? And someone who's yani an acquaintance. You see him at times, you don't see him a lot of times, you speak to him at times, and you ignore him other times. But your kareem, your intimate companion, that's your buddy. That's the one that you share everything with. You're close, your best friend, your khalil. Allah says, whoever turns away from the remembrance, then we will assign for him shaitan, and he will become his best friend. And you know what the problem is? The continuation of the verses. And verily, the shaitan will be misleading this person. He will hinder him from the path of Allah, while the person thinks that he is rightly guided. This is the calamity. That the shaitan will be leading him astray, or her astray, and they think in themselves, we are rightly guided. I am on the way to Jannah. My iman is on full. You cannot add anymore. I do so many good deeds. MashaAllah, I do A, I do B, I've done this, I give sadaqah, I give da'wah, I help the needy and what have you. A person will think, wallah, he's going straight to Jannah. And Allah knows that this is the shaitan, his kareem, leading him astray while he thinks that he's rightly guided. Then what happens on the day of judgment? Allah says, until when he comes to us on such a day, which is on the day of judgment, he will say to him, I wish the distance between me and you was like that of the two easts. Yani, the east and the west. I wish the distance between me and the shaitan, that person will say to him on the day of judgment, the longest distance. فَبِئْسَ الْقَرِينَ. What a horrible companion you were. So then, the shaitan who will lead us astray may become our friend if we turn away from the remembrance of Allah. So brothers and sisters, we need to wake up regarding this particular reality, because we find that we are busy with television, and the children busy with PlayStation and Xbox and Nintendo and all these games, busy with listening to haram, busy with going on picnics and enjoying oneself, which we're not saying is wrong, but too busy that we don't have time to fulfill the obligations. At least fulfill the obligations. Set aside the voluntary acts of worship. set aside the voluntary acts of worship, which we all need, the obligations, keeping the kinship ties. When was the last time we visited our relatives? When was the last time we visited a sick brother or sister in Islam? Although we know that they are sick, speaking about myself, we have shortcomings. When was the last time we fulfilled the rights of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? We will find that not only we don't have enough voluntary acts, we're not even doing the obligations. And we are violating the limitations and the prohibitions of Allah. And this is because we are too busy and we have turned away from the remembrance of Allah, and this is what we got in return. So then we must be careful of the shaitan. And as Allah says, إِنَّ عِبَادِي لَيْسَ لَكَ عَلَيْهِمْ سُلْطَانٍ. This is what we need. Verily my slaves, you will have no authority over them. The more we are a slave to Allah, then the more we'll be honored with Allah. And the more we'll be protected from the shaitan. He cannot come close to the slaves of Allah. He will catch you occasionally on small things that you will soon repent to Allah from, and it will be as if you never did anything. But the problem is, some of us are too arrogant to be slaves of Allah. Some Muslims think they are too good to be humble to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Rather they complain and criticize the deen. Oh, too many things to do, too many things to leave alone. Everything is haram, haram, haram. You hear some strange statements from some people. This is an indication that our iman is not sound. And our iman is running low. So brothers and sisters, we must prioritize. Prioritize for our children. These children, they don't need Xbox. They don't need that. They need to know the story of the Sahaba, the stories of the Sahaba. They need to know the biography of the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ. They need to memorize the Qur'an. Look at the situation of the Muslim Ummah. Do you think this happened to us because we were following the deen strictly? No. Because everybody got busy with life. There were no people were left to keep this deen moving. So then we are in this situation. I'm not saying throw away the Xbox. This is another issue. You know, you know your children better. I don't want to, you know, make anyone think that we're trying to be extreme here. There's moderation in everything, as long as there's nothing prohibited in the very games that they play. There's no harm in enjoying oneself. But this should not be the main goal. Too much time is being wasted on these things, and not enough time given to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and not enough time given to the remembrance of Allah, which in return gives prevalence for the shaitan, and authority to the shaitan to be among the reasons why our iman will be decreasing. Next, the dunya, the world. If anyone has this kind of car, I didn't know. Don't think that I see a new car and I'm trying to give you a subliminal message that you should buy a Toyota Tercel or anything. That's not my intention. But this is usually what is considered to be a luxury car. So I figured it's only befitting that I quote it. This dunya, I mean, who can tell us about the dunya better than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Everybody reads Surah Al-Kahf every Jumu'ah. I hope if you're seeking the reward of reciting Surah Al-Kahf as a voluntary act. I'm sure you come across the ayah, وَاضْرِبْ لَهُمْ مَثَلَ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا كَمَاءٍ أَنْزَلْنَاهُ مِنَ السَّمَاءِ فَاخْتَلَطَ بِهِ نَبَاتُ الْأَرْضِ فَأَصْبَحَ هَشِيمًا تَدْرُوهُ الرِّيَاحُ وَكَانَ اللَّهُ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ مُقْتَدِرًا الْمَالُ وَالْبَنُونَ زِينَةُ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَالْبَاقِيَاتُ الصَّالِحَاتُ خَيْرٌ عِنْدَ رَبِّكَ ثَوَابًا وَخَيْرٌ أَمَلًا. Allah says to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and strike for them the similitude of this life is like rain that we send down from the sky. And then it mingles with the earth, so vegetation grows fresh and green. Then soon it will become dry and it will be broken into pieces, and then the wind will scatter that away. And verily Allah is able to do all things. المال والبنون زينة الحياة الدنيا. Wealth and children are the adornment of this life of this world. والباقيات الصالحات خير عند ربك ثوابا وخير أملا. And the righteous deeds that are everlasting are better with your Lord in terms of reward, and better with your Lord in respect of hope. The life of this world is like rain that mixes with the ground, and then it looks pretty. And this is a similitude to the one's life. As soon as you become 25, 30, 35, you finish college, huh? You bought your nice house, everything is looking good, everything is green and fresh, all of a sudden a calamity befalls. Either some financial calamity where everything goes away, or a physical calamity where you go away. You leave, and it becomes like a broken pieces that are scattered with the wind. Nothing is left. It's only fake. It was interesting for a moment, not for a long time. The vegetation does not remain green and fresh for a long time. Sooner or later it will become dry, and then this wind will take it away. This is an example of the life of this dunya. Wealth and children are only an adornment. Adornment is like jewelry that the women wear as means of beautification. Children also will make you look better. How you have a good boy? People say, mashallah, good boy. You have money? Likewise, people may praise you for your money or for your children. Now, unless these are being an investment for the hereafter, then as Allah says, subhanahu wa ta'ala, they are only adornment of the life of this world. They may be good for you, they may be your good deeds, but they may be not. It depends on how do we utilize them. Do we utilize them as means of seeking the pleasure of Allah? Having these children someone who will make dua for you after you pass away? Having your child someone upon the deen who will continue to seek forgiveness for you after you die? If this is the case, then the children are not means of destruction. But if it's the other way around, when the child becomes the parent, and maybe you've seen them, the parent is actually the child, and the child is the parent. Whatever the child wants, goes. I want this, he will get that. I don't want this, then he will not get that. I don't want to go there, then they will not go. I want this, and you know what I'm saying? Where the father and the mother simply are obedient to the child. So whatever the child wants, whether it is good for them or otherwise, the parents will continue to carry it out. Then these fall under this particular ayah. They're only an adornment. You may enjoy them, but the righteous deeds that are everlasting, that you present, are better with Allah in terms of reward. If you want reward, then the good deeds that we perform. What are they? They are every act of worship that we do. They're not only subhanallah, alhamdulillah, wa la ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar, as it came in some explanations, it's actually beyond that. Every act of worship that we perform will be better with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in terms of reward, and better in respect of hope. Hope for the mercy of Allah and hoping entering Jannah. And the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in an authentic hadith, he says, verily, I do not fear poverty for you. I do not fear poverty, but I am afraid of the world that it will spread out for you as it spread out to those who came before you. Then you will compete in it as they competed in it, then it will destroy you as it destroyed them. He wasn't afraid of poverty for us sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He was afraid that the dunya will spread out. Huh? Come to me. So we will compete in the dunya. The same way those who came before us competed in the dunya, and then it will destroy us as it destroyed them. And the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Inna dunya hulwatun khadira, wa inna Allah mustakhlifukum fiha, fayanzuru kayfa ta'malun, fattaqu ad-dunya wa taqu an-nisa." The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, as he said, "Verily this life of this world is green and sweet, and Allah has placed you as deputies on this earth to see how you're going to behave. So protect yourself from the temptation of the world, this worldly life, and protect yourself from the temptation of women. Because verily the destruction of the children of Israel, the Jews, was through women." This is indication that if a person does not fear Allah in his relationship with women, then this is among the reasons why a person will become astray, and he will deviate from the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the dunya is sweet, and it is beautiful, but we must prioritize. We must remember the hereafter. What did Allah prepare for us in the hereafter? What has been prepared for the believers in Jannah? Eternity in Jannah. Pleasure and bliss in Jannah. Looking at Allah in Jannah. Speaking to Allah in Jannah. What is that compared to this nonsense that we have today? Nothing. We're not saying that you should go live on a mountain as some extreme, you know, Sufis do. He says, "Khalas, I'm going to be ascetic." And he lives on the mountain, he doesn't speak to people, he doesn't do anything, all day he does salah. Then he begs people for money. This is not praiseworthy either. Rather, we are people of wasat, middle path, moderation. You seek the dunya, you need money to survive, you need money not to ask people for money, you need money to feed your children, you need money to educate your children, so you need to go after this life, but with moderation. Not at the expense of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah's rights. not on the expense of missing on the salawat and missing on the obligations and disobeying Allah in order to attain the dunya. So we must be careful of the dunya, because it is among the reasons why one of us may be running on empty in this life of ours. Associates, your buddies, excuse me. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "Al-mar'u ala deen khalilih, falyanzur ahadukum man yukhalil." Or kama qala sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, the man or the woman is upon the religion of their companion. Actually, khalil is, as we said earlier, is more than your average companion, your close buddy, the one that you love more than the rest of your friends. He said, so let each one of you look, who is he befriending? Who are you hanging out with? You know, the righteous predecessors were so serious about this issue that before they would even associate themselves with a person, they will see who are his friends. If his friends were no good, then they automatically put him in the same category, unless they know that he's advising them. He's someone who's mixing with them to bring them to repent to Allah. But if these are his buddies, the one that he hangs out with, then of course, naturally, who do you feel attracted to? Someone who's like you. Who is your friend? The one who likes the same things, to read the same kind of books, huh? And to listen to the same kind of beneficial lectures. I'm not going to say anything else because nothing else is acceptable, really. You know, your friend is the one that you have commonalities. You share things. So when you see someone associating with the people of corruption, the people of innovation, the people of disobedience, then this is among the main reasons why someone will be led astray. We may go astray because of the company that we hang out with. And the righteous predecessors used to be so exact about this understanding that one of them used to say, إِذَا رَأَيْتَ الرَّجُلْ يَتَسَاهَلْ بِالصَّفِّ الْأَوَّلْ فَغْسِلْ يَذَكَ مِنْ. If you see a man being careless or negligent about praying in the first row, wash your hand away from him. Clean yourself from him. Don't hang out with him. Did you hear that? If the brother's not keen on praying in the front row, if someone's telling you, ma'alish, ma'alish, ya akhi, stop being so extreme about the salah. We could go a little late. Back then, they say, don't go with this guy. He will continue to do this to you until you fall under the statement of the hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And a group of people will remain to delay and be late to the salah until Allah will cause him to stay behind. It will begin, huh? The first time he will tell you, the second time, until you say, yeah, maybe I am extreme. Maybe I'm extreme, khalas, I just go with the flow. We could just be late to the salah, and you will continue to do that until you continue to associate with him, and then being late to the salah will become one of your qualities. Why? Because you were hanging out with a person who had this particular quality. And this is something that each one of us can experience in our lives. Some of us even imitate the laughter of our friends. Maybe you used to laugh a certain way, but then your friend laughs another way, then you start laughing like them. To this extent, we pick up from one another when we are friends. So we should be careful, brothers and sisters, who we befriend. When we see people who are disobedient, we try to bring them back. It doesn't mean we boycott them or we don't speak to them. We need each other. We must advise them. And we will associate with them with the intent to advise them. But our friends should be the righteous people. You hang out with righteous people, you will become righteous, bi-idhnillah. You hang out with people who read the Qur'an, you will read the Qur'an. Look at the people of the halaqah and the tahfidh. They hang out with each other, they all have the same direction. Similarly, you hang out with good brothers, huh? You will be among the good brothers. You hang out with good sisters, for the sisters, then you will be among the good sisters, bi-idhnillah. And vice versa. Causes for the increase of iman. First and foremost, it is learning beneficial knowledge. Having knowledge of what? The Book of Allah and the Sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Actually, the most knowledgeable of the creation was commanded to have knowledge per the verse in the Quran where Allah commanded the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam by saying, فَعْلَمْ أَنَّهُ لَا إِلَهَا إِلَّا اللَّهِ. And believe me, no one knew Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Not any human being during his time, not even the prophets and the messengers who preceded him. No one knew la ilaha illallah more than the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Yet he was commanded in the Quran to have knowledge of la ilaha illallah. And la ilaha illallah is the deen of Islam. So then we must have knowledge. We must have knowledge of the Quran and the Sunnah. And the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in the hadith sahih, مَنْ يُرِدِ اللَّهُ بِهِ خَيْرًا يُفَقِّهُ فِي الدِّينِ. Whoever Allah intends goodness for, He will give him understanding of the deen. And we mentioned this before. He will not give him memorization of the deen. Oh, mashallah, hafidh. But there's no implementation. There's no implementation. Rather, He will give him understanding of the deen. You understand one ayah, you understand one hadith, and you put them into practice, then Allah intends goodness for you. And alhamdulillah, in this country, it is unlike many other countries. For two reasons. The number one reason is that knowledge is readily available here. There are da'wah centers, there are lectures being conducted as this one. There's always room for knowledge. You're being invited. All you have to do is come. It's not the other way around. Secondly, and all praise is due to Allah, the knowledge is sound. The knowledge is sound. It is correct. It is not extreme. It is not deviant. It is not innovative. If you see someone teaching other than Quran and the Sunnah, then leave. But alhamdulillah, as you see, you're being taught the Quran and the Sunnah. قال الله وقال الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم. In other countries, ya akhwan and brothers and sisters, they don't have this privilege. They may have a hard time finding a place to learn, and if they do, Allahu a'lam what they're teaching. Allah knows what they're teaching. They're not necessarily teaching the sound knowledge. So we have been given a blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by allowing us to live here, work here, reside here, and go about our daily lives in this country. A unique place to be in terms of Islam. As you see, alhamdulillah, Islam is alive. There are some there's disobedience, there's sins, there's transgression, but it is limited, unlike other countries. So then we should be grateful to Allah. When you hear about knowledge, try to seek knowledge as much as you can. Even if the people that are teaching you are not the biggest scholars, we're only giving you some what the scholars have said and sharing some minor information with each other, but it is beneficial bi-idhnillah. And the more you have knowledge, the more your iman will increase because you'll be worshipping Allah based on understanding. And this is not the same as the ignorant. قُلْ هَلْ يَسْتَوِي الَّذِينَ يَعْلَمُونَ وَالَّذِينَ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. Say, are they equal, those who know and those who know not? And everybody knows that they are not equal in any way, shape or form. Reciting the noble Qur'an and contemplating on it. And I remind the brothers and sisters that it is called the noble Qur'an or the glorious Qur'an and not the holy Qur'an. There's no such thing as holy Qur'an. Holy means muqaddas. And the book of the Christians is called Al-Kitab al-Muqaddas. Al-Kitab al-Muqaddas. And the Kitab is Bible. So the holy book, which is the holy Bible. Now have you ever read in the Qur'an or in the Sunnah, the Qur'an being called Al-Qur'an al-Muqaddas? No. It is muqaddas, it is holy in a sense, because it's from Allah as an attribute, but not as a name. And we know from the understanding of the deen that there's a difference between the attribute and the name. Right? There's a difference even in the names and the attributes of Allah. Allah has many attributes, but they're not names of Allah. لَا تَأْخُذُهُ سِنَةٌ وَلَا نَوْمٌ. No sleep or slumberness overtake Allah. This is a quality of Allah. But that's not a name of Allah. You don't say the name of Allah, لَا تَأْخُذُهُ سِنَةٌ وَلَا نَوْمٌ. You don't say the name of Allah, وَلَمْ يَكُنْ لَهُ كُفُوًا أَحَدٌ. But these are qualities of Allah. So the quality is unlike the name. The quality of the Qur'an is that it is holy. But Allah in the Qur'an called it, بَلْ هُوَ قُرْآنٌ مَجِيدٌ. It is a glorious Qur'an. Qur'anun Hakim, the wise Qur'an. Qur'anun Kareem, the noble Qur'an. Never been called the holy Qur'an. So some Muslims have gotten this because the Christians have a holy Bible. So they said we're going to have a holy Qur'an. Actually, this has no basis. So my advice to myself and you is for future reference, use the noble Qur'an or the glorious Qur'an. Because we are honored with the Qur'an, we don't need to imitate anyone else's name. Alhamdulillah. And it was never used by the Qur'an and the Sunnah. And if it is used as an attribute, not as a name. And we stick to that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us because Allah knows best what is befitting as a name for the Qur'an. He called the Qur'an al-Majid, Qur'an al-Kareem, then we do the same thing bi-idhnillahi azza wa jal. Contemplating upon the Qur'an. أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ أَمْ عَلَى قُلُوبٍ أَقْفَالُهَا. And the same ayah, a different ayah began with the same first part of the ayah. أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ وَلَوْ كَانَ مِنْ عِنْدِ غَيْرِ اللَّهِ لَوَجَدُوا فِيهِ اخْتِلَافًا كَثِيرًا. Two ayahs in the Qur'an that are trying to send across the same message. And which is a rhetorical question asked by Allah. Do they not reflect upon the Qur'an? Do they not ponder upon the Qur'an? The first ayah says, or are the hearts locked? Do they have locks over their hearts that they do not ponder upon the Qur'an? The second ayah says, and had it been from other than Allah, then verily they would have found in it much discrepancy. If the Qur'an was from other than Allah, then like the many other scriptures that are available today, you will find a lot of contradictions, a lot of differences, a lot of discrepancy. But the Qur'an is from Allah, so you do not find any of that. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is encouraging us to have tadabbur. And this is among the reasons why the Qur'an was revealed. كِتَابٌ أَنزَلْنَاهُ إِلَيْكَ مُبَارَكٌ لِيَتَّبَّرُوا آيَاتِهِ وَلِيَتَذَكَّرَ أُولُو الْأَلْبَابِ. A book we have sent down upon you, O Muhammad, full of blessings. Blessed the Qur'an. Why? لِيَتَّبَّرُوا آيَاتِهِ. So they may reflect and ponder upon its verses. And so the people of understanding may take a reminder. So this is the objective of the Qur'an. And Al-Hasan al-Basri, rahimahullah, said something very interesting which I will summarize. I'm not going to quote him word for word. He said, you have someone today who tells you, Akhi, I read the whole Qur'an. I did not even miss a single letter. He said, and by Allah, he has missed the whole Qur'an. If you look at him, he has nothing to do with the Qur'an. His behavior, his conduct, his lifestyle, his appearance, his morality has nothing to do with the Qur'an. But he will tell you that I read the whole Qur'an and I did not miss a single word, a single letter. He said, by Allah, he has missed the whole thing. He will tell you, I can read the Qur'an a whole chapter in one breath. He said, wallah, if this is the case, then may Allah not increase these kinds of individuals among the ummah. Why? Because recitation of the Qur'an is not the main objective of the revelation. ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ هُدًى لِلْمُتَّقِينَ. That book, there is no doubt in it. It's a guidance for those who are pious. Now let me give you an example. Let's say you get a book of science. You read a book of science without understanding. You don't know the meaning of the word. You just learn how to read English. Okay? They told you that the R sounds like an R and the N like an N, but you don't know the meanings of the words. And you read a science book. Will you benefit from it? You may read it very nice, you know? And you begin from the first chapter to the last chapter. And if someone asks you, what does it teach? Oh, say, oh, I don't know English in the other language. I know how to read English. But I didn't learn vocabulary. I have no vocabulary, no definitions. Can we say that this Quran, this book of science, excuse me, will it benefit the reader? It's not going to benefit the reader. You must understand what is being said. So do we understand the Quran? Huh? How many of us, don't raise your hand. How many of us, when we read the Quran and we come across some verses, we actually bother to read them in the language of our mother tongue? Whatever the language you speak, how many of us actually have another book, another interpretation of the meaning of the Qur'an in their mother tongue language? So when they go home, they see what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling them to do. How many of us do that? Or do we just read the Qur'an in Arabic? Huh? In Ramadan, read, ajr, alhamdulillah. But then where's the implementation? So we must reflect upon the Qur'an, reciting the Qur'an and contemplating on the Qur'an. Putting the Qur'an into practice. When Aisha radiallahu anha was asked about the character of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, she said, كَانَ خُلُقُهُ الْقُرْآنِ. His character was the Qur'an. He was a living Qur'an walking amongst the people. And today, we have become rough. Muslims have become a little rough, specifically with the non-Muslims in the field of da'wah. We expect to bring people to Islam when we don't live a according to the Quran, in terms of our conduct, our behavior. ادعو إلى سبيل ربك بالحكمة, with wisdom, والموعظة الحسنة, and good preaching. So you find someone wants to give da'wah to a person, but he's working with him and he's always mistreating him. Then one day he tells him, hey, you know, you should become a Muslim. The person is not going to buy that. You must, you know, let me give you an example of what da'wah is like. Da'wah is like getting a shot. You know when you go to get a vaccination, huh? The doctor gives you a needle. Da'wah is like that. What does the doctor do before he gives you the needle or the nurse? Huh? What do they do? Rubbing alcohol, huh? A little massage, huh? Some preparation. Take it easy. They get the place easy. Take it easy. Before we give you the needle. When you give da'wah, you must gain a person's heart first. You must gain him first. Before you give him the dosage. The dosage, the needle is the painful truth. When you shock them that they're from the wrong religion, and your religion is the truth. And the actual medicine is the truth, Islam. So if you try to give someone a shot as soon as you see him, bah, ala tol. He's going to run away. Say, man, what is this doctor, man? I'm never going to come back to you. You hurt me. He may get an infection, huh? Because he didn't clean the area. So you must first do some preparation prior to giving da'wah. Similarly, we must gain the hearts of these individuals before we deliver the message of Islam to them. So when we live according to the Qur'an, you have no choice but to act in this way. But because we do not follow the guidance of the Qur'an, we may be a little rough. Rough, not during the lecture. I'm always rough in the lecture. You have to forgive me for that. I'm speaking about the one-on-one. When someone is sitting next to you, you know, you have the smile and stuff. You don't get excited as I'm getting excited. You have the better chance to deliver the information in a gentle fashion. So, similarly, we must follow this particular manhaj in our da'wah bi-idhnillahi azza wa jal. Next, knowledge of Allah's most beautiful names and most exalted attributes. And this actually is the essence of knowledge. Every form of knowledge is a branch of this knowledge. Because the purpose of the creation is worship of Allah. And for us to worship Allah, we must know who we're worshiping. We must know the names and the attributes of Allah. Now in the hadith that was narrated by the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ, which is sahih, أَنَّ إِنَّ لِلَّهِ 99 إِسْمًا مَنْ أَحْصَاهَا دَخَلَ الْجَنَّةِ. Verily, Allah has 99 beautiful names. Whoever enumerates them will enter Jannah. Many people have a misunderstanding about this hadith. They think that if they memorize the names of Allah, then they will enter Jannah. No. Rather, there are three levels. As Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah mentioned, again I will be quoting him by the meaning of a speech. Three levels of knowledge of Allah's names and attributes. First, memorizing them. Memorizing the name. Because the hadith says whoever enumerates them. Secondly, understanding their meanings and implications. What does it mean when you say Allah is Wadud? Or Allah Qawi? Or Allah Hakim? Allah Rahim? Allah Rahman? All the names and attributes, what do they mean? We must know the meaning, the implication, and the third level, we should supplicate to Allah according to them. So we say, oh most merciful, have mercy on me. Ya Rahman, irhamni. And Ya Ghafur, ighfirli, and so forth. These are the three levels. And we must give some time to know the names of Allah and His attributes. We must learn who we are worshipping. Otherwise, brothers and sisters, we may be worshipping in vain. Many Muslims today have a misunderstanding about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they ascribe things to Him that do not befit His majesty. And others deny many of the names and attributes of Allah because they do not have the proper understanding of them. So we must be very careful. And among the most fundamental of knowledge is the knowledge of Allah's names and attributes. There are many books that have been compiled that actually deal with each one of the names and they give you the definition and how you could implement them in your life. And this is from the mercy of Allah. In any language you speak, you will find this information available. I advise myself and you to invest into this kind of book so we will know who we are worshipping, because the problem with every other religion upon earth is that they do not know Allah. Some say He is a human being, some say He is an animal, some say He is a statue, some say He is one of three, and the list goes on. And the very problem of them, the reason why they were disqualified from belief, is because they do not know who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is. And this is the worst kind of ignorance that we may have. So I remind myself and you to exert some time to learn the names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala so we can put them into our life. When we know that Allah is the most merciful, then we have hope in the mercy of Allah. When we know Allah is severe in punishment, then we are afraid of the punishment of Allah. When we know Allah is Sami'an Basir, the all-hearer, the all-seer, then we know Allah hears us whenever we say something wrong. Allah sees us when we do something wrong. When you are mindful of Allah like this, then your iman is going to increase and we will be acting accordingly. We'll be conducting ourselves in a manner that is pleasing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To look attentively at the biography of the noble Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and verily if you read the seerah, and one of the most better put information in the book of the Seer Nectar by Shaykh Mubarak Furi rahmatullahi alayhi, you know, this was they won a competition when they presented a competition about who can compile the best autobiography of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and this particular book won. Alhamdulillah, it's available in English. And I advise myself and you to read the seerah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. See how he lived his life, how he conducted himself. And this will be means of you imitating him. Because sometimes you will not understand the hadith until you see how it was actually put into practice by the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in his seerah, in his biography. Then you will see how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala aided him, how Allah protected him, how Allah supported him. So this will increase your iman. Because you feel that you're following the best man who ever walked upon this planet. So this will increase your love to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and as a byproduct of that, then your iman will automatically increase as well. And many Muslims today, they know the biographies of singers and actors and foolish people. They know everything about them. One day we're born and everything, but they know nothing about the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam except celebrating his birthday on a day which is not really part of the deen to begin with. And so, we must read the seerah, get acquainted with the seerah, learn the way he conducted himself, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, for me and you to see how far we are. Just look at the way he treated his wives, and look how me and you treat our wives, if you are married, excuse me. Wallahi, you will be shocked. We are horrible. We may be horrible with our wives, absolutely nonsensical with our wives, and the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had to deal with 9 and 12, and he managed with the kindness and gentleness and with the jealousy that they had. I mean, you can only imagine what it was like. Read the seerah and see how he dealt with them, alayhi salatu wassalam. So when we read this, then we look at ourselves and say, man, I'm a lousy brother. I need to fix myself. But sometimes we forget unless we read the seerah. So I remind myself and you to get attached to the way of the life of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, so our iman will increase, because dhulm is a problem. When you mistreat your wife, it's oppression. And oppression is darkness on the Day of Judgment. And it will not be forgiven unless she forgives you. And if she doesn't forgive you, then you'll be held accountable on the Day of Judgment. So this situation is serious. We must become acquainted with the biography of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam for us to live according to him. Sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the best who ever walked on this earth, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala send his peace and his blessings upon him and his companions and all of us bi-idhnillah azza wa jal, if we follow them on the righteous path. Reading the life and the stories of the salaf of this ummah, our righteous predecessors. Yani, if you read their biography, whether it is the companions or the tabi'een or atba'u tabi'een and those who came after them, you would be shocked at these pure souls. Pure souls and clean hearts. This immense love for Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. People who cared for this deen. People who strove for this deen. Some of them who travel long distances to hear a hadith from the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now one of us is too lazy to look it up on Google. Too lazy to put it in Google to see whether the hadith is sahih or not. As soon as he gets an email, forward to everyone, akhi. Allah will reward you. Forward. Forward ala tu. Yalla waddi. Khalli waddi. You get some crazy information in the email. See, what is it? Ya akhi, a hadith, da'if, ma mawdu'. This is lying against the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Bother ya akhi to search? Bother to ask a brother who knows? Ma'alish akhi, I don't know Arabic. Can you refer to the references in the Arabic to tell me whether this hadith is acceptable for me to forward it? Or I should stop? Too lazy. But Imam Bukhari went all over just to hear a hadith. He will pray 2 rak'ah for each hadith before he added to his book istikhara, 2 rak'ah before he added hadith. Now we don't even look up a hadith online before we forward it to the brothers and gain sin as opposed to gaining reward. So when you look at their lives, you realize how lazy me and you are. We're so lazy, it's not even funny. Everything has become convenient for us. You want the whole deen of Islam, you get it on a CD. Go to Maktab al-Shamila. Since when does everything Islam is on one CD? You know, this was the hard work and effort of thousands of people who came before us, who dedicated their lives for this information. Now you get it on a CD for 1 riyal. You pop it into your computer, yalla. The whole knowledge is within reach. And we're still too lazy to benefit. So when we read their lives, we will reconsider what we are doing today. And perhaps it will be means for us to imitate them. And Shaykh Islam ibn Taymiyyah rahmatullah said, he said, verily, if you imitate them, then you're imitating the best. This is good enough for you. The meaning of a speech. If you imitate these people, what else do you want? Imitating the Sahaba and those who came after them? Wallah, it's a sharaf. It's an honor for one of us to imitate these individuals as opposed to imitating the singers and the actors and the actresses and the players and the soccer people and all these people. Who are these people? They dedicated their life for the dunya. And these brothers dedicated their life for the akhirah. And we leave them alone and we take the new ones. So we should reconsider our objectives in life. Reflecting on the universal signs or al-ayatul kawniya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Look around you, ya akhwan, brothers and sisters. Look around you. Look at yourself before you look elsewhere. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala directed us towards this understanding. أَفَلَا يَنْظُرُونَ إِلَى الْإِبْلِ كَيْفَ خُلِقَتْ وَإِلَى السَّمَاءِ كَيْفَ رُفِعَتْ وَإِلَى الْجِبَالُ كَيْفَ نُصِبَتْ وَإِلَى الْأَرْضِ كَيْفَ سُطِحَتْ. Do they not look at the camels, how they were created? This amazing animal, which has this endurance to maintain in the desert with little water. And this, the way it works as an animal is outstanding, unlike the cows and the sheep and everything else. Do they not reflect upon this creation of Allah and the sky, how it was raised? And the mountains, how they were made to be firm, fixed in the earth? And the earth, how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it flat and spread it out for us to move upon it like we are moving upon it right now? So this is a reminder from Allah to ponder upon the creation. Ponder upon yourself. This mind that you're using right now, how is it except listening to me? Now through your ear, you're not seeing words. You're listening to the words and then your brain translates them to you to knowledge, information. And then you store them. It's an amazing machine. It's an amazing machine that we have in our body every day of our lives. This, when you see the greatness of the creation, what does that tell you? The greatness of the Creator. If we, the children of Adam who came from a sperm, are that sophisticated, are that great in creation, then what about the heavens and the earth? And then after you look at about the heavens and the earth, then what about the one who created everything? Subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when you know the greatness of Allah, your iman will increase. You cannot possibly believe properly unless we know who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is. And the creation, everything in this creation is a sign of the oneness of Allah. Everything in the creation is indication that Allah is the only creator and the only one who deserves our worship. Exerting efforts towards accomplishing sincere righteous actions. Doing good deeds, actions of the heart, loving Allah, fearing Allah, tawakkul ala Allah, relying and depending upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you're working in the haram, and a brother tells you, akhi, this is haram, leave it alone. If you have this active worship of the heart, depending on Allah, you will leave the haram knowing that Allah will give you halal in return. You have dependence on Allah, that if you leave it for the sake of Allah, Allah will give you something better in return. But we don't have this, we continue to gain from haram because we really don't rely upon Allah. We think it's the haram that is sustaining us, not Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So these are among the actions of the heart. Sincerity, being sincere, ikhlas, sidq ma'Allah azza wa jal, all these qualities which we may lack or we may have some deficiency in. We need to also work on them, ikhwan, purify our hearts. The diseases of the heart are the most vital and the most fatal. So we must make sure that our hearts are pure and we cleanse them from every disease that may afflict them, which will cause us to be heedless, as we mentioned in the beginning of the lecture. So the actions of the heart is among the things that we must strive for. Secondly, the actions of the tongue. Reciting the Quran, remembering Allah, enjoining the good, forbidding the evil, which is all part of da'wah. All of this is part of da'wah, inviting others to Islam. These are among the active acts of worship that we may do with our tongues, that will be means of our iman to increase. You give da'wah to one person whom Allah guides to Islam, and this will be better for you than the dunya and everything that is upon it. One person becomes a Muslim through you, wallah, you may be guaranteed Jannah. And you don't have to do the whole da'wah. You may give him a ride. You may give him a book. You may give him a pamphlet. You may just treat him nicely. The Prophet ﷺ said, whoever calls people to goodness, he will have a reward equal to theirs, without their reward diminishing the least bit. If someone becomes a Muslim through you, then as long as they worship Allah, and pray to Allah, and fast, and do zakah, and do hajj, and do umrah, and remember Allah, you will get an equal reward, even after you die. And if they teach other people what you taught them, then you will gain the reward of the other people as well. And you will find yourself that your iman is soaring because of da'wah that you're making. So then again, the actions of the tongue, enjoining the good, forbidden evil. You see someone doing something haram, don't be afraid. Stop. Tell him, ya akhi, this is haram. Fear Allah. Fear Allah. Don't be shy. We must enjoin the good and forbid the evil. This is among the best actions of the tongue, which will increase our iman bi-idhnillah azza wa jalla. Because Allah says, kuntum khayra ummatin ukhrijat lin-nas. You were the best nation ever produced to people. Ta'muruna bil-ma'roof wa tanhawna 'anil munkar. You enjoin what is good and you forbid what is evil. So we should put that in our lives, beginning with our wives, our children, our neighbors, the community we live among, the people in our country, everyone. Muslims and non-Muslims. With the non-Muslims, you enjoin the good by calling him to Islam, forbid the evil by preventing him from shirk. And with the Muslims, then each according to his needs. Lastly, the actions of the limbs. قَدْ أَفْلَحَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ هُمْ فِي صَلَاتِهِمْ خَاشِعُونَ وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ عَنِ اللَّهُ مُعْرِضُونَ إِلَىٰ آخِرِ الْآيَةِ. They have attained success, the believers who are submissive in their salah, and those who stay away from idle talk. All these are acts of worship that you do with the limbs. قَدْ أَفْلَحَهُ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ هُمْ فِي صَلَاتِهِمْ خَاشِعُونَ. Look at the combination between the iman and the salah. They go one in one with each other. Allah says, إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ إِذَا ذُكِرَ اللَّهُ وَجِلَتْ قُلُوبُهُمْ وَإِذَا تُلِيَتْ عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتُهُ زَادَتْهُمْ إِيمَانًا وَعَلَى رَبِّهِمْ يَتَوَكَّلُونَ الَّذِينَ يُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةَ وَمِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ يُنْفِقُونَ. Verily, the believers, the only believers, are those who are such that when the name of Allah is mentioned, their hearts tremble. And when the signs of Allah are recited upon them, the verses of Allah are recited upon them, their iman increases. And this is the evidence, among the evidences that iman increases and decreases. زَادَتْهُمْ إِيمَانًا. It will increase them in faith. And they rely upon Allah. Those who establish the salah and they spend from that which we have given them. So Allah says that the believers are those who iman, their iman increase among them, establishing the salah. And establishing the salah for the brothers being at the masjid at the right time, at the right place, and doing the salah properly. If my brother insists in Islam, if you stand in the salah and you don't think about the Fatiha, we are in trouble. If you stand in the salah and as soon as you begin, you start yawning. And you say, Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen, Rahman, Rahim, Malik, Anbiya, Al-Abdiya, Al-Nasta, Allahu Akbar. Wallahi, wallahi, everything I mentioned is applicable to us. It is impossible, impossible for a believer to be truly a believer and he will stand in front of Allah to pray and he will be so negligent about what he's saying in the salah. Impossible. So if we have this quality, we must check, make a major check on our lives. What are we doing? Is the salah just a burden on our back that we need to get it finished? So we just do it as movements, huh? Exercise, up and down, up and down. Do we stand in the salah and know when we say Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen and we pause for Allah to respond to say Hamidani Abdi, my servant has praised me. Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, do we read the Fatiha in this particular fashion? Do we feel that we are asking Allah to guide us? Do we feel saying when we say Subhan Rabbi Al-Azim, Subhan Rabbi Al-A'la, when we send the peace and the blessings upon the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam? Do we feel this act of worship? If our iman is good, then inevitably we will be as Allah described us in the Quran, الَّذِينَ هُمْ فِي صَلَاتِهِمْ خَاشِعُونَ. And this is all part of khushu' or submissiveness. So this is among the factors that we may be heedless about. How is our salah? We will use the salah to judge where we are on this gas gauge. We will only know based on the salah. I will do my own check, and brothers and sisters, you do your own assessment and your own check. If we're not doing the salah the way it is pleasing to Allah, according to the way of the Prophet Muhammad, if we do not think about what we're saying in the salah, meaning we need to make sure that everything I mentioned earlier in the lecture is put into practice in our lives before we say goodbye. Before we leave without having our iman in a level which will guarantee us Jannah. And we said, if we're not going to Jannah, then you know where else we're going to go. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك. جزاكم الله خيرا. There's a website there that has a little humble stuff. It's a humble website, everything is humble there. Don't expect anything fancy. But if you missed the lecture or you want to share this particular lecture with others, then you will find it on this website. It's one of these free ones. I hope they don't change their mind and ask for money one day, then we'll have to cancel it out. And if you have any questions, you can always advise me, because I need a lot of advice. And I do appreciate those who advise me after the lectures or through the phone about some of the errors I may have or my behavior or whatever. I'm open, inshallah, to any comments and criticism in order to improve myself. I don't claim perfection in my presentation, and I'm fallible, I make mistakes. I try to correct myself as I learn from the advice of the brothers and sisters. So feel free to advise me at this particular website, onewaytoparadise@gmail.com. Make sure you're not too harsh on me because I'm sensitive. My question is related to your comments about associates. In order to bring our friends to the right path, isn't it connection more important than correction? If we don't connect, how do we communicate effectively? Actually, we're not saying cut off the connection, but there's level of communication. Connecting with someone is at various degrees. Now, if you cut yourself off, then how are you going to invite them? How are you going to correct them? It's impossible. So you must maintain a link, but that link is measured according to necessity. يعني you only hang out with them enough to deliver the message you want to deliver. You don't do things that are not needed for you and that will not be beneficial in your reminder. So each person should evaluate يعني the situation. This is, it's situational as they say, depending on the person, the level of their deviance, and the level of your ability to correct them, and how much is required for you to communicate, connect with them for that. It doesn't mean that you go do everything evil with them because you want to bring them back because it may backfire. They may take you with them instead of you bringing them to your side. So you save yourself first. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا قُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ then وَأَهْلِيكُمْ Oh, you believe, protect yourselves, then your family from the fire. So someone would burn himself for others to have light. And then, you know, you just are melted like a candle. So we must have some wisdom in to what extent we connect with these individuals. How do we start a clean, covered black heart? In a time where it's hard to find good companions, where do we go? Regarding the first question, the next lecture, inshallah, the coming week, this coming Monday, not same time, it will be at 8:45. Next Monday, inshallah, Zakallah Khairan, 8:45, the lecture will be exactly about that. How do we clean a black heart? What do we do? If we were among those who are running on empty, I hope that no one dies from now to next week. What do we do in order to fix up the situation and fill up our tank? Bismillah Azza wa Jalla. So I will not elaborate on this now. If it's in a time where it's hard to find good companions, where do you go? You go to your room and you do not mix with the evil people. But alhamdulillah, there's always good companions. I don't think this is even a valid statement. Alhamdulillah, there's goodness in the ummah. There are good brothers. You just have to continue to search. And you may not find 15 of them, you may find one. But one is good for you. One is better than nothing. Can we use our free time during duty hours for some kind of Islamic propagation? It depends on your boss. If your boss does not mind that you use the internet or otherwise for da'wah purposes, if you have completed your job, zakallahu khairan, then yes. But if your boss knew that you're doing something personal during work time, and he would be displeased with you, then it becomes haram for you to utilize a business, even a piece of paper. You don't even have the right in Islam to get a piece of paper from the company for your own personal use, so you can take it home. If you know that your boss would not accept that. Because this is a form of dhulm and khiyana. You're betraying the trust. So really, we must be careful of that in this sense. So it depends on your boss. If he allows you, alhamdulillah. If he doesn't allow you, then you seek permission first. If he says no, leave it alone. Allah will give you something better in return. Or you could do it outside your duty. If someone is sick and give him a local medicine that contains alcohol, can he take it? Allahu a'lam. Because the scholars have differed about the usage of alcohol as an intoxicant or as a medicine, and actually the fuqaha has some detailed explanation which I do not recall right now. So I will not give an answer, but if you email me on this website inshallah, on this email address, then bi'idhnillah azza wa jal I will give you the answer, because there is an answer, I just don't have it with me. Is it okay to hear audio of speech, etc. instead of reading? Yeah, whatever. Some people don't like reading. And so it doesn't mean you leave alone, seeking knowledge. If you like to hear lectures, barakallahu feek. As long as you are gaining some knowledge, as long as you are interacting with the deen of Islam, whether it is through reading or through listening or through speaking, it depends on the individual. Alhamdulillah, everything is halal, you find whatever is fit for you, but reading is very beneficial. So try to struggle with yourself the same way you have to read in school. You cannot tell your mother, huh? Wallah, I don't want to, I'm going to get a zero in geography, why? I don't like to read. You know, they will throw you outside the house. They'll make sure that you're going to read the whole geography book before the examination, because it's worldly related. So similarly with Islam, if it is means of you gaining more knowledge, then strive to start liking to read. And perhaps Allah will make you, you know, desire such an act of worship. What are the most accurate websites available to gain Islamic knowledge? Wow. Also, how can we understand its integrity if seek knowledge of Quran and Hadith through the internet? Well, I cannot really give you the websites right now, but I do have a number of them. You can also email the question, inshallah, then I will reply to you with a number of websites that may be of benefit. Now, if I do reply to the websites, it doesn't mean that I agree with every single thing in the website. Because sometimes the website is good, but they have some issues, so there may be some reservations regarding some of the sites, whether they are extreme in some fashion or otherwise. But I will still give you, inshallah, references to trustworthy places where the knowledge is sound, and it is according to Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, and you know, the right methodology, bi'idhnillah azza wa jalla. Was this coming from... this is taken. A book of tafsir, you know, is good. If it's in English, then you know, the one that is readily available is Tafsir Ibn Kathir, rahimahullah. I believe it's 10 volumes or so. It's an excellent book of tafsir in whatever language that you speak. And I think it's been translated to many languages. So that's the one I know is available in English. There's the tafsir of Sheikh Abdurrahman Nasir al-Sa'di, rahimahullah, but it's only available in Arabic. So if you do speak Arabic, this is an excellent book of tafsir for you to have. When our Prophet Muhammad ﷺ passed away, who led them in Salat al-Janazah? When the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ passed away, there was no one imam for the janazah. Rather, the Muslims entered in groups, each of them praying janazah and leaving. One group will enter, and the other, then they will leave. Then another group entered thereon, and so forth. There was not a single imam who led them in the Salat al-Janazah as it was done during his time, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or afterwards. So this is what the biography of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam indicates. Now, and it looks like this is the questions. If anyone has any verbal question, you may ask. Otherwise, I've held you for too long already. And I know maybe some of you have to rest for tomorrow's work. Does making or performing Umrah and fasting will wash away the major sin? Actually, the hadith indicate that the various acts of worship that were mentioned by the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ that are means of sins being expiated, such as saying Subhanallah bihamdihi 100 times a day, among the other different things. They say, because of one hadith that says, مَا تُجُنِّبَتِ الْكَبَائِرِ أَوْ كَمَا قَلَى صَلَّى, as long as the major deed, the major sins are, يعني not, they're not established. يعني you did not commit major sins. Said the Jum'ah to the Jum'ah and the Salah to the Salah and Ramadan to Ramadan will forgive all the sins as long as you do not commit major sins. Many of the scholars, they carry the interpretation into the Umrah and otherwise, that the Umrah to the Umrah will forgive whatever is between them as long as the major sins are avoided. But for the major sins, if this is the opinion of some of the ulama, the major sins, the only way really to resolve them is by what? Repentance. You repent, Allah, alhamdulillah, it's easy. To repent to Allah, all you have to do is feel guilty. Huh? We will deal with that next week, inshallah. But anyways, all we have to do is repent. So from what I know, the opinion of the scholars is that these virtues of the sins being forgiven, all of them, is with the exception of the major sins that one commits. These require an independent repentance. Wallahu a'lam. We don't know how to read and write Arabic. We are no Muslim. We want to learn. Teach us so that we can understand more. Oh, mashallah. Okay. Bi-idhnillah. We have da'wah centers that have been established particularly for your services. Alhamdulillah, they're free of charge. And all you have to do is show up. Particularly on Fridays. This is a day where there's a lot of activities in English for the English speakers. Different classes, you learn the Tahara, the Aqeedah, the Salah, alhamdulillah, everything is being conducted. There are many different da'wah centers in Jeddah here. And they're all over the Mamlaka, all over the kingdom, alhamdulillah. And so inshallah, I have the phone number, I will give you all the information. Brother Ibrahim, we're happy that you're a new Muslim. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keep us and you affirm upon the deen and increase the likeness of your, the individuals like yourself who are striving to learn. Look, mashallah, this is a reminder for me and you. A new Muslim is looking to learn and better himself. So inshallah, we should follow their footsteps. Which website in English is available to check the authenticity of hadith? I have not come across anyone in English. There's one in Arabic called durar.net. D-O-R-A-R.net. It's an excellent website actually that has al-mawsu' al-hadithiyya. And you put some of the wording of the hadith and it gives you everything about the hadith. All of the scholars of hadith and all of the ulama al-jarh al-ta'dil, those who study the chain of narrations and those who label the hadith or the sahih, da'if or what have you. I don't have anything in Arabic. But if you present the information to me, I will research it for you, then I will give it to you in English, inshallah. So you get to have it in English. And I also have access to some of the students of knowledge in Medina who are, alhamdulillah, well-educated and they're English speakers. So if any problem is beyond our ability, we can always refer to those who can ask the scholars and give us the information in English. So we have no excuse. You want the information in English, we'll bring it to your house. All you have to do is just inform us, inshallah.